I'm Gayle Laakmann McDowell, author of Cracking Coding Interview. Today, I want to talk about memoization and dynamic programming. This is a super important topic. It's challenging a bit at first, but once you get the hang of it, it gets a lot easier.
Fibonacci is pretty much the classic recursive example. Fib of n is a sum of fib of n minus 1 plus fib of n minus 2. And then we need some starting conditions like fib of 0 is 0 and fib of 1 is 1. And we can very easily write out the first few cases here. But now let's think about the code. So translating this into code, very straightforward as well. But there's a problem when we think about the runtime here. So if we call this for, say, fib of 6 will call fib of 5 and fib of 4, 5 will call 4 and 3, 4 will call 3 and 2, etc., etc., etc. Then we finish a single branch, and we still need to do all the other branches. So that's going to get very, very inefficient. Specifically, if we imagine calling this for, say, fib of n, we're going to call fib of n, and that's going to call n minus fib of n minus 1, fib of n minus 2, fib of n minus 3, dot, 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 all the way down, roughly n levels. So we'll have n levels in our tree. The first level will have one node. The second level will have two nodes. Each node has two children, so we'll have four nodes on the next level, then eight, and so on and so on. So if you take one, you double it n times, because we have double the number of nodes at every single level, we're going to wind up with roughly 2 to the n nodes in the tree. So this gives us a runtime of O of 2 to the n. And if you remember, I was able to compute this by hand fairly quickly. And so there's a bit of a mismatch here. Why is this algorithm so inefficient? And the reason is that we keep doing things repeatedly. We compute fib of 4 twice, here and here. Fib of 3 gets computed 3 times, here, here, and here. Fib of 2 gets computed 5 times, here, 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 and here. Now, obviously, these values haven't changed. Fib of 4 is always the same thing. Fib of 3 is always the same thing. So what we should be able to do is just compute these values once, and if we ever have to compute them again, just return the stored value. So we store the value each time, rather than computing it from scratch. And that's what the most basic implementation of a memoization algorithm is. So now, if we walk through what this code does, we're still going to go and compute this whole path down here. But when we do that, we're going to build up this table. So then when we get down to computing fib of 1, well, that's a base case. Fib of 2, hey, already been computed. We just returned that value. Fib of 3, already computed. Fib of 4, already computed. So although we still recurse just as deeply, all our other work has been done by that point, and we're just returning stored values. And now we get a linear runtime instead of exponential, which is, of course, an enormous improvement. So now let's talk about space complexity. Space complexity comes from any memory you use. And that includes, yes, things like creating arrays and stuff like that, but it also includes the call stack. So let's think about the space complexity of the non-memoized solution. A lot of times people will describe this as O of 2 to the n, and that's actually a mistake. People were thinking, well, gee, all O of 2 to the n things are all in the call stack, so we need all of that. Yes, but they're not all on the call stack at the same time. One way to think about space complexity is, if I were to give you a chunk of memory to run your program, how big would that chunk of memory have to be? Although all O of 2 to the n things wind up in the call stack over all time, they're not all sitting there at the same time. The biggest your call stack ever gets, the most memory you have in use at any one point in time, is O of n. There's only O of n things that wind up on the call stack at any one given time. So the space complexity of the non-memoized solution is O of n. The memoized solution also has a space complexity of O of n, because we need O of n memory for the call stack still, and we need another O of n memory for the memo table. But O of n plus O of n is still O of n. So both of these have a space complexity of O of n. Now let's try this out on a new problem. Suppose you're given an n by n grid, and you can only move down or to the right. And certain cells are blocked off in this grid. The question is, how many paths are there from the top left to the bottom right? As you might guess, we want to approach this recursively. So let's break this down into smaller problems. The overall problem is, how many paths are there from the top left to the bottom right? Well, let's think about this green guy in the top left corner. The first decision he needs to make is, well, am I going to go down or to the right? Those are my only options. So let's picture each of those options. There are only those two ways of going. So the number of paths from the start to the end is the number of paths from position A to the end, plus the number of paths from position B to the end. So now we've broken down our problem into other subproblems. So now what happens? Well, person A has to go either down or to the right again. Same with position B. So now the number of paths from A to the end can be broken down into C and D. It's the number of paths from C to the end plus the number of paths from D to the end. Same thing with B. It's the number of paths from B to the end is the number of paths from C to the end plus the number of paths from E to the end. This recursion stops when we have a definitive answer, and that comes when we're actually at the end. The number of paths from the end to the end is just one. You stand exactly where you are. So that forms our recursion base cases. Translating this into code is relatively straightforward. We just traverse down and to the right, obviously making sure we check, you know, that we're not out of bounds or in a blocked off square. But then we just sum up the number of ways of going down plus number of ways of going to the right. And when we get down to the actual end, we return one. This is a pretty straightforward implementation of that algorithm. Valid square does both the boundary checking as well as making sure we're not in a blocked off square. If we are, then we turn zero because there's no paths. If we're at the end, return one because there's just the one path, you stay right there. Otherwise, number of paths from here to the end is the number of paths going down to the end and plus number of paths going right to the end. One little tip, by the way, whenever I do a matrix problem, I like to use row and column for my variable names rather than X and Y. And the reason is that the X coordinate actually translates to columns and the Y coordinate translates to the rows. But people tend to instinctively write grid of X comma Y, and that's backwards. It should be grid of Y comma X. It just leads to a lot of confusion, so take it from me. Don't use X and Y when you're dealing with matrices. Use rows and columns instead. Well, one thing we might notice is that in the example above, we compute the number of paths from C to the end twice. And that's unnecessary. What we should be doing is saying, hey, if I've already computed something, just return that stored value. So every single thing I compute, I want to just store that value and return it if I'm ever asked for it again. And that's a memoization approach. Now instead, we just compute it once, and then if we ever need that value again, just return that stored value. And that's all we have to do here. The runtime now is O of n squared because we have n squared possible cells that we have to compute this for. But in each time we compute it, it's constant time given that we have other work already done. So that gives us a runtime of O of n squared. So if we want to, we can flip this around and do more of a traditional dynamic programming approach. So let's take a look at how this would work. If we think about what the recursive approach does, the very first concrete values it gets, other than the base cases, are these two cells. And so that gives us two concrete answers. Now, where can we go from here? Well, the next thing, if we take that recursion one step up, the next thing it does is it might be filling in one of these three cells. So let's start with this one here. Well, we know the answer to that cell, and 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 that cell. All of these cells have just one path from their cell to the end, which is this path here. Now, what about this cell here? Well, if there's one path going down, one path going to the right, the actual answer is their sum. So there's two paths there. Now here, again, one path there. Now, when we go to this cell, there are two paths going down or to the right. So the sum is gonna be these two, just the sum of those two cells. And this one here, well, we can go down or we can go to the right. There's two paths if we go to the right, one path if we go down. So the actual result for the number of paths from this cell to the end is three paths. And we can double check that if we want. One path is going down and then all the way over. Another path is going to the right, down, and then all the way over. Or to the right again, down, and all the way over. So sure enough, yes, there are three paths. And we can do this exact approach going through the entire grid, starting from the bottom left, moving to the left, starting from the bottom right, moving all the way to the left, up one row, all the way to the left, up one row, all the way to the left, filling in these values as we go. So we're going to a zero here, because there's actually no paths from this cell down to the right. And here there'll be three, because we can only go down. Here, three again, we can only go to the right. Four, one, 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 1, 1, and then 3 here, 7 here, 1, 2, 1, 2. And we can go through and fill in the entire cell, the entire matrix this way. Our runtime is still O of n squared, and so is our space complexity. But we've reduced the actual amount of memory used slightly because we no longer have to use a call stack. So these are a couple different ways of approaching problems. You can tackle things recursively. That's often a pretty good way to get your handle on the problem in the first place. Then you might implement a memoization approach and just throw in a memo table. Maybe that's a hash set, a hash table. Maybe just a simple integer array will work. And sometimes you can easily flip that around and implement an iterative traditional dynamic programming approach. So try these problems out. I'd really recommend before your interview practicing a whole bunch of these. These problems are actually pretty formulaic, and once you get the hang of them, they can be very, very easy to tackle. But when you start off first, they can be kind of tricky. So do your best, practice these, and good luck.